Crusade Radio. Crusade Radio has been our flagship now for more than 10 years. And, of course, now we're also coming up on Ustream.tv. We are television. We are up. We are live. Thank you so much for watching the show today. By the way, if you're listening on Crusade Radio and you'd like to watch the show, just simply go to thewileydrakeshow.com. Thewileydrakeshow.com. It's simple. It's easy to get there. And simply go, thewileydrakeshow.com. It's on the air. It's on television. And we welcome you. Now, during this radio and television show, if you call me, if you call me on my cell phone, I will answer it. If you call me on other phones here in the studio, I will answer them. And by the way, if you want to get your pen and write these numbers down, I'll share them with you. But before we do that, I want to tell you that the reason we do this show, we deal with a lot of subjects. We deal with some very controversial subjects. We deal with some subjects that are dangerous to a lot of people. But most of all, we deal with it from a scriptural perception. Now, the theme for this show is do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. So that's what we're going to deal with today. If you'd like to reach us, you can call me on our 800 number, 1-800-839-3002. You can also call us on the Congressional Prayer Conference line of Washington, D.C. That is area code 202-747-4839. That's our Washington, D.C. number. We'll be giving out another number tomorrow morning at 11 a.m. D.C. time because we'll be on the Sunshine Radio Network. They're on two a.m. stations in New York, Rochester, Brockport. I'm sorry? Too loud?
It's giving me a crackle.
Oh, okay. All right. We'll get it down. All right. We're getting a feedback. Technician says we're getting a feedback because we're so close to the microphone with our Crusade broadcast microphone. We'll move now ahead. All right. If you'd like to call us on the 800 number, 1-800-839-3002. And if you need to call us on another number, we'll give you some other numbers as those are needed. We'll not go through all of those numbers right now. But what I do want to do is I do want us to go and talk about a new friend that I have. I have a new man, a new friend, and I'll be honest with you, folks. I don't make friends quickly, but when I see people that are on the same page that I'm on, then I try to befriend them as best I can. I met a gentleman by the name of William Bill Windsor, and he has a web page called Lawless America. And we're on the same page because both of us are very, 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 very upset about what's happening to our children in America. It's one thing, it's terrible for people to kill babies in the hospital. It's a terrible thing to go to some old clinic somewhere, dirty, nasty, and to kill babies. But it's even worse when our government is abusing those children. Let me see. Hello, caller. You're live on the air on the Wiley Drake Show. Can we help you?
Yeah. I know it's 5 o'clock. Their time is over there. I'm right down the street from you guys. I'm just calling to see if I can still get a bed available.
Well, you just come on up for dinner at 5 o'clock, and we'll talk to you. Thank you so much. God bless you. Thank you for calling, but we're live on television and radio right now, so we'll talk to you a little later.
What channel are you on?
We're on Ustream.
Ustream.tv
on the internet.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Thank you for your call. Please let the line be available for other callers. All right? Bye-bye.
Is this the church?
Yes, it is.
Oh, okay. Is this not the DJ?
Sir, can we ask you to please free up the line? We need this for our callers. All right, I think he's freed the line. I hope so. If not, I will. I know where the off button is. And I just freed the line, whether he did or not. I don't know. But anyway, try not to be that way, folks, but when folks just insist on taking over and asking questions, then I have no choice but to hit the off button and get back to business. If you'd like to call us, you can call us on 1-800-839-3002. Now, I met a fella via the internet a day or two ago. His name is William Windsor, Bill Windsor. Bill is upset about the fact that children are being taken away through Child Protective Services. Those people that are supposed to protect our children are not. They're taking the kids away. Bill is traveling around the country, and he is recording on video your story. So if you have a story, go to his webpage, contact him. The webpage is lawlessamerica.com. Lawless, L-A-W-L-E-S-S, America, lawlessamerica.com. Bill has been traveling. Bill is now in Ohio. And let me just read one of his latest postings. And here it is. Was it a hooker or was it a government agent? Bill Windsor gets a surprise visitor to the set of Lawless America, the movie. At around noon on July the 24th, a light knock was heard at the door of Bill Windsor's hotel room in Cleveland, Ohio. Bill says, and I quote, "I opened the door to see a stunning young woman wearing a little black evening dress, black hose, high-heeled shoes, and expensive-looking jewelry. While all of the women who have come to be filmed have been beautiful inside and out, none have been dressed like this." So Bill's question is, was this a hooker knocking on the door, or was it Uncle Sam, Secret Service? Would not be the first time. Would not be the first time. I had a lady come to my door one time when I was traveling around the country, when we were doing more of the investigation like we're doing now, like we're back in, and I had a beautiful girl knock on the door of my hotel room and say, "Hello." And I said, "Hello, what can I do for you?" Now, I wasn't doing filming, wasn't doing anything like that, like Bill is doing. I was just traveling to be with families who had lost their kids. And as she stood outside the door, she said, "Aren't you going to invite me in?" And I said, "No, ma'am, my wife would not approve of that." And she looked at me and laughed. And I said, "My wife would not approve of me inviting you into my hotel room. So, no, I'm not going to invite you in." And she said, "Oh, come on, don't be an old square." And I said, "Well, I am an old square, and I'm married to my wife, and I'm going to stay married to her. So no thanks. Thank you. Good night." And I closed the door. Well, that was supposedly the end of it. But having had a background, being a private investigator, I went over to the restaurant the next morning where there were some people having breakfast in sort of a back nook or cranny of the restaurant there at the hotel. And so I went there, and when I went to the restroom, they quietened up when I walked by. I walked by and went on into the men's room, made a U-turn and came back out. They could not see me, and I got to the area where I was close to them, but they could not see me. And I happened to have a listening device in my pocket so I could hear what they were saying. And I listened in on them, and it was obvious they were agents of the government. They were talking about calling D.C. They were talking about their supervisor, and they were talking about the encounter she had had with me the day before. And she said, "You're going to have to change your tactics. He is not going to be giving in to having a hooker come to his room." And she made it very clear to them that she did her best to entice me, and hope that they would tell her boss that, but that I was not enticeable at that point. And one of the guys jokingly said, "Oh, yeah, he'll give in. Just try it again." At that point, I walked out of there. They saw me again, got very quiet, and I turned to him and said to him, "I am not going to be enticed. I think I've already made that clear to you." And so they knew then their cover had been blown. They knew that I had been listening in on them. And they split, and that's the last I saw of those guys, because I'm sure their supervisor said, well, you guys were burned. That's a term in the industry when the people that you're trying to follow, the people that you're trying to monitor, find out who you are and where you are, you're burned, so you got to go home. And so they had to go home. So those are the kind of things, folks, that go on all the time. And I'm here to tell you that we are in the business of doing an expose, the expose of the damage to our children. Many of you, if you'd like, can go on YouTube. Just put Wiley Drake in on YouTube. In fact, if you want to hear what we have done here in California, go to YouTube, put in Wiley Drake plus CPS. Put in Wiley Drake CPS, and you will see a tape that was done quite some time ago. And so we're here to take back our country, ladies and gentlemen. Every day here on the Wiley Drake Show, on the worldwide broadcast, on Crusade Radio, and on the Wiley Drake Show, we're going to be in the studio. We're going to work with Bill. We're going to work with other folks. We're going to work with families. Now, let me say to you, Bill is doing a documentary that's going to end up being a movie. And I am not detracting from that in any way. Please help him in any way that you can. Please help him financially. Please help him any way you can. And if you have a story, tell him your story. If you would like to tell your story here on television and on radio, all you have to do is get in touch with my producer, my personal assistant and helper and scheduler, and we'll book you on the show. Now, if you come into the studio, we will keep you anonymous if you so desire. If you want to be on camera, and quite often I have people that say, no, I'm fed up, I'm tired of it, I'm willing to come on camera. And if that's the case, come in the studio, sit right here across the desk from me, and let's hear your story. And maybe as we get down toward the end, we can even use a little Paul Harvey and say, and the rest of the story is this. And so we encourage you, tell your story. We have this effort that we're moving forward that is gravely needed, ladies and gentlemen, and it will be done in memory of our dear friend, Senator for the 50th District of Georgia, Nancy Schaefer, and her husband, who were shot and killed because of their exposing this whole situation. And that's why when Bill travels, why when I travel, I want people to know. And I want everybody out there to know I am not suicidal. I lost my wife a year and a half ago, and I am a lonely man because I do not have my wife of 48 years. But I'm here to tell you, I'm not distraught. I did not lose my wife. I know where my wife is. My wife is in heaven, and I'll see her again one day. And I want everybody out there to know I'm not suicidal. I'm going to live till Jesus comes. In fact, I'm here to tell you that one night in a dream, I woke up at a birthday party. And I don't normally have a lot of dreams. I'm known as a Babdecostal, but I don't have a lot of dreams and a lot of visions and a lot of things like that. But one night, I sat up in the bed and I thought, my goodness, what's going on? I was at a birthday party. And at that birthday party, there was a big banner across the front of the room, and it said, Happy 100th Birthday. And I thought, my goodness, that may be my friend down in San Diego. She's 102 now. And so I thought maybe that is her birthday party. And then I looked at the banner again, and on the bottom of the banner it said Happy 100th Birthday, Pastor Wiley Drake. In my dream, I was at my 100th birthday party, and I saw it as real as I could see anything on television. I saw it as real as I'd ever seen anything in a dream. Now, does that mean God's going to let me live to be 100? I hope so. I'm going to do my best to live to 100. And if there's somebody out there that you're planning on taking me out, you would do me a favor if you took me out, because I'd go to heaven. But I'll tell you something right now. If you're planning on taking this old man out, you better come packing heavy, because I do, and I will take you with me if you try to take me out. In fact, I may take you out before you get a chance to take me out. And so a guy got surprised at me today. A guy came by the church here and made a very loud, obnoxious knock on my door. It was a loud, loud knock, and it was the very first knock was very, very loud. Well, I went to the door immediately, and when I got to the door, his eyes got very big, because when I got to the door, I was not empty-handed. And he looked at me and said, "What's that all about?" And I said, "Well, you were making a lot of noise. I had no idea who you were." And so then I emptied my hand, and we went about our discussion. Now, I'm not saying that to brag. I'm just saying to warn anybody about that. My friend Nancy Schaefer and her husband were both shot to death over this very issue. And I don't plan on getting shot to death. Anyone wishing to tell their story is welcome at our studio at 6801 Western Avenue in the city of Buena Park. In fact, we're just up the hill, just up the street a ways from Knott's Berry Farm. And I hope my friend, my attorney friend up in Northern California, who is the high up in the legal profession, I hope he's listening, because we are gearing up. I may need your help, my dear attorney friend, but most of all, ladies and gentlemen, I need your prayers, and I need your advice. We're going to go after this thing big time. Families are welcome to tell their story on an on-screen telephone call, as well as call-in numbers. You're welcome to call in right now and tell us your story. And if you want Bill Windsor to film your story, he'll be glad to do that. If you want to come in and be in our studio, we'll be glad to have you. Well, we're assuming some things here, folks, that are very, very, very important. The information that you get from this station, the information you get from me, is indeed about testimonies and stories and about investigations. And we're going to investigate. Let me see who this is on the phone. Good afternoon. This is Pastor Wiley Drake. You're live on the Wiley Drake Show. Can we help you?
Yes, Pastor. You're off of Beach Boulevard and Orange Thorpe, right?
No, we're on Western and Orange Thorpe.
Western.
All right. The guy's having a tough time getting here, finding the place. He's looking for a shelter. By the way, folks, for those of you who may be listening for the first time because of this Child Protective Service fiasco, because of what we're doing with Lawless America and Bill and others, you may be listening to my show for the first time. I want you to know that all of this work that I do to protect families is not my first job. My first job is to be the pastor of First Southern Baptist Church in Buena Park. Good afternoon, First Southern Baptist Church, live on the Wiley Drake Show. Can we help you?
Yeah, I guess we got cut off, I guess.
No, we didn't get cut off, my friend. I'm going to hang up on you because we're running a television and radio show, and I don't have time to just talk about the weather. So thank you. God bless you. Goodbye. That's a guy that's just insisting on tying up our telephone, and I'm not going to let him do that. That's why I know where the button is. if you'd like to call, you're welcome to call. I'll try not to hang up on you. I'll try to let you talk if you want to talk about the subjects that we're discussing. The subject we're discussing is the Wiley Drake Show, doing justice, love, and mercy, and walking with God. We're also talking about Lawless America and Mr. Bill Windsor, William Windsor, and what he's doing to help families. Ladies and gentlemen, I mean it when I say the theme of this program is not how to get you here to the church in time for dinner. The theme for this program is do justice, love mercy, and walk with God. Now, we'll help you, we'll feed you, we'll clothe you, we'll reach out to you, but we must go on with the show. Just across the way here in Hollywood, they say the show must go on, and the show is going to go on here with or without help from the community. But doing justice is at the top of the list. And ladies and gentlemen, I do not believe for a second that that was coincidence. When Micah was dealing with God's people, he said, do justice, love mercy, and walk with God. Jesus in the New Testament said, justice, mercy, and faith, the same three things. Now, what does that mean? That means that one of the greatest injustices in this world is killing babies. And the second injustice in the world in which we live today is the damage that's being done to our children through foster care and through illegal and through all of the problems that Child Protective Services are carrying on. These poor parents oftentimes are targeted to lose their children because they do not have the wherewithal to hire lawyers. Ladies and gentlemen, it is not against the law to be poor in America. And by the way, it's not against the Bible to be poor. The Bible says you'll always have the poor with you. And the Bible says we're to minister to the poor. That's why my church that I pastor has a homeless shelter here to take in the homeless off the street, whatever reason they're homeless. But poor does not mean that you're not a good parent. You may be dirt poor. Your kids may not have fancy clothes. Your kids may not be as well taken care of as families who have lots of money. But being poor does not mean you're not a good parent. Your child should not be removed from you because you're poor. And yet, we know that that happens quite often because a family is poor. In fact, let me give you an example of one that happened right here in Buena Park. There was a man that brought his son-in-law and his daughter and two little boys to our church, and they said, our daughter and her husband and kids have no place to go. We live in a condo, and we're limited on the number of people we can have and the number of visitors. So we're not able to have them with us in our condo because of the association rules. So we're wondering if they could stay here at your church. And we said, yes. And they said, well, we'll be glad to pay you for it. And I said, no, if you want to make a donation to the church, you're welcome to do so, but we don't charge. And so that man and his wife and two little boys came here to this church. Now, after they were here for a while, they slept here at the church. They did their homework here at the church. They ate here at the church. And after a while, the father began to be a little bit concerned because we do have homeless people here. And he said, Pastor, I can't stand it to have my daughter and my grandkids in a homeless shelter. And I assured him that it was clean. I assured him that it was safe. And he said, I know that, but I just cannot bring myself to leave them in a homeless shelter. And I said, well, brother, I'm not bucking for business. So if you don't want them here, that's your business. And so he took his daughter and son-in-law and the two boys down the street to a motel, put them in a motel room that was a two-room motel. You had an entry room and then a back room. It had a refrigerator. It had couches. It had beds. Had a television, of course. And so they put those kids up, and he paid for their hotel room for their children to be there. But he said, I have limited income. And can they come to your church to eat? And I said, certainly. They can come and have all of their meals at the church. They don't have to stay here. And so they did. Every morning, he and his wife would get up and they would walk up the street and they would bring those children to our church to have breakfast. In fact, the matter is, there were several times that I had breakfast with them because at that time we only had two other children in the church. And I wanted to be over there to be pastor to these folks as best I could. So they were staying in a local motel, sleeping there, doing their homework there, and taking the children to school just up the street. And then they would come here and have breakfast, go to school, we would pack them a lunch, and then they would come back after school and have dinner here at the church. Now, that was the ongoing routine. I had had breakfast with them that morning, and we had pancakes and sausage. I remember it well. And I had somewhere I had to be, so I said to them, I'm going to eat quickly, and I'm going to be out of here. And they said, well, we have to hurry up and eat too, because Mom and Dad have to take us to school. So they took them to school, and I left. Later that morning, about 11 o'clock, I got a call from a teacher at the local school where these boys were attending and said, Pastor Drake, you better get over here. Social services are on campus. So I went over there, and the social worker said, what are you doing here? Who are you? And I said, well, I'm their pastor. And they turned to them, and the husband was already there, and so was the wife. And they both nodded and said, yes, he's our pastor. And so then that's when she said, well, I'm sorry. Due to confidentiality, you're not allowed to hear what I say to them. That's an absolute lie. It's against the law, but they did it anyway. And so they talked to the parents, they talked to the children, and then they said, we need to go and investigate where they're living. Do they live here at the shelter? I said no, and I explained the circumstances, that they ate here, but they were not sleeping here. They were staying in a local motel. They went to the motel. They checked the motel out, and here is what it said in their notes. The motel room was disheveled. Now, they had slept there all night, so the beds were not made. Maid service had not come in yet. The beds were not made. And they took photographs of that, the unmade beds. And then they went over to the refrigerator. They opened the refrigerator, and they took, this is a few years ago, Polaroid pictures of the empty refrigerator. And they took those Polaroid pictures of the disheveled bed and the empty refrigerator, went back to Orangewood, the CPS headquarters, and opened a case and said, we're taking those children away from those parents because they're being neglected. There was no food in the refrigerator. That was only a partial truth. They didn't need any food in the refrigerator. They ate here at the church. When I tried to explain that, the judge threatened me with arrest if I didn't get out of the courtroom because I was trying to tell him, Your Honor, the fact that the refrigerator was empty has nothing to do with the parental care. They've been eating at our church, and we've been taking care of them. And he said, one more outburst from you, Mr. Drake, I'll put you in handcuffs and drag you out of the courthouse. And so he turned to the bailiff and said, if Mr. Drake says one more word, put him in cuffs and take him out to the hallway. And so a little later, they brought in a psychological evaluator and said that the evaluator had checked these boys out, and the report said there was nothing unusual. But when the social worker presented the case to the judge, she said, Your Honor, our proof that these folks are not taking good care of their children is threefold. Number one, they're not taking good care of them. The room was a mess. Number two, there was nothing in the refrigerator. And number three, they had to be psychologically evaluated. Now, all of that was a lie, but that's what they used. They took those boys away from that family, and it took them 27 months and $50,000. The father of the family was not a wealthy man. He took out a second mortgage on his home to get enough money to get a lawyer. And so after $50,000 and over 2 years, they finally got their kids back because the kids were not being neglected and the kids were fine. Now, folks, that is an example of what happened right here at this church with this pastor. And that's why I'm upset with social services. They use those kind of tactics all the time. They use them over and over and over again to take children away from their parents. By the way, it was 1 year into that event. The grandma and grandpa had to get their attorney to demand that they have grandparent visitation. Social services said, we're not going to give those kids back because they might let them visit their grandparents. And their grandparents, obviously, are not fit. They're too old, and they were not even in their 60s. They were in their 50s. But social services said the grandparents are too old to take care of the kids, and therefore we're not going to let the kids go back in the home. And folks, I could amplify that story more. I won't spend more time on it, but I could tell you something, folks. Those kinds of cases are rampant across Child Protective Services. And often parents that are indeed capable of making mistakes end up paying for those mistakes over and over and over. And I'm here to tell you, folks, my wife and I were married 48 years. My oldest daughter is 48 years of age. My youngest child is 34. We raised three girls and a son. And I'm here to tell you, over the years, we were not perfect parents. We did not have a lot of money. And there would have been many times Child Protective Services could have come in and taken our children away from us because of what they call perceived neglect. We did not have a lot of money. We did not have a lot of things to give them, but they were fed properly and clothed properly and taken care of. In fact, the matter is, one of the other cases that we have where the children were taken away for legitimate reasons, the family was using drugs, and they got in trouble, and they took the kids away. They put their plan into service. They took all the classes. They tested clean and sober for over a year, but they still would not give their children back to them. They took parenting classes. They took anger management classes, but they said they're still not fit to be parents. What a tragedy. In so many cases, these things go on over and over and over again. The separation of families is growing, and it is a growing business because of local governments have decided they want that money, and they get that money to help their budgets. You see, Child Protective Services and juvenile court can always hide behind confidentiality. And by the way, the other family that I was telling you about, they went through all the hoops, they got their life squared away, and they still said, we went to court with them, and they said, yes, they put their plan into effect. They've gotten off drugs. They're not drinking. They're not doping. They're good parents. But they have an association with Pastor Wiley Drake at the First Southern Baptist Church, and we don't think that's good for children because the church teaches that without Jesus Christ, if you die, you go to hell. And they said in court, that will damage the children. And they said, as long as they take those children to a Baptist church, we're not going to let you have your children back. The only way they could get their children back, and of course I recommended this, they had to sign an affidavit that they would not place their children in our church at any time, and then they let them have their children back. Ladies and gentlemen, that's a tragedy. They said it was a tragedy, the family, but they had to do what they had to do to get their kids back. The Adoption and the Safe Families Act that Bill Clinton put into effect has absolutely gone berserk. They are merchandising these children because they get money when they keep them in the system. This is a double dipping that's going on, especially with kids that have special needs. We had another family. They were getting $1,000 for having this child in the system. And the child was having trouble in his math class, and the teacher said to the parents, you need to help him a little bit. Here's a book, a little extra book to help him work in, because he's having a little difficulty with his math. And so the mother and father started using the book, the special book, to teach their son math and to help him bring his grades up. And so he brought his grades back up to a B. But they said, we'll not let you have your children back because you're not capable of educating them the way they should be educated. Now, here were students that were making B's, folks, and yet the system said that's not good enough. That there are no financial resources and no real drive to unite a family is over and over in front of us. The incentive of social workers to return children to their parents after taking them away has faded by the wayside. This must end. That's why we're working with Bill, and that's why we're working with you, and that's why we want you to call. If you'd like to call and give us a report on your case, you're welcome to do so. That's 800-839-3002. 1-800-839-3002. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we must get to the root of this thing. We must fight this thing. When the lives of the children were improved, removing them from the homes, there might be a greater need even for protective services. But today, all children are not safer. Children of whom I am aware have been raped and impregnated in foster care, and the head of a foster parents association in our district was recently arrested because of child molestation. Did you hear that, ladies and gentlemen? The head of a foster parents association. This is an association that sets up foster homes for these children. That head of that association was arrested because of child molestation. Some parents are even told that if they want to see their children or grandchildren, they must divorce their spouse. Many of the times I've had families come to me and say, Pastor, what does the Bible teach about divorce? Well, I'm sort of narrow-minded. I believe God meant what he said when he said, till death do you part. Child Protective Services are saying, if you do not divorce your husband, you do not divorce your wife, we will not allow you to have your children back. Many who are underprivileged are feeling they have no option. We'll divorce and then just continue to live together. I talked to a family just last week, and they said to me, Pastor Drake, we've got our lives back on target now. Would you perform a wedding ceremony for us? And I said, yes, but only after we counsel and talk about it. They explained to me that social services had told them that if they did not get a divorce, they would never get their kids back. And so they went down and hired an attorney, and they got a divorce. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is an anti-family policy. They got the divorce. They did what social services told them to do. They dotted the I's. They crossed the T's. They got a divorce and continued to live together in the same home, continued to be together as mom and dad, but they were legally divorced. After they finally cleared their case, they came to me and said, we have been divorced now for 2 or 3 years, and it was because of social services, and we want to be married again. So it was my privilege to counsel with them and perform their marriage, and they're now married again. Ladies and gentlemen, This is an anti-family policy that Child Protective Services have adopted. Fathers, especially non-custodial parents, are oftentimes treated as criminals without access to their own children and have child support payments strangling the very life out of them. The foster parent's Bill of Rights does not bring out that a foster parent is there only to care for a child until the child can be returned home. It is a permanent kind of situation. Many foster parents today use the foster parent's Bill of Rights to hire a lawyer and seek to adopt the child from the real parents who are desperately trying to get their child home and out of the system. Many of these children are adopted out because people hire attorneys and get them hired out immediately. Tax dollars are being used to keep this giant system afloat. Yet the victims, the parents, grandparents, guardians, and especially the children are charged for the system's services that grandparents have called from all over the state of Georgia trying to get custody of their grandchildren. They claim that relatives are contacted, but there are cases that prove differently. Grandparents who lose their grandchildren to strangers have lost their own flesh and blood. The children lose their family heritage, and their grandparents and their parents lose all connection to their heirs. We had a situation not too long ago where a woman and her mother were able to get back together. They had been separated from each other since the little girl, who is now an adult, was about 8 years old. And so they were separated. They moved across country. But with the advent of the computer nowadays, you can find folk. So this young lady, as she graduated from high school and went off to college, said, "Oh, I'd love to know who my mother is. I know that I was taken away from my mother. I don't know why, but I know I was taken away and put in foster family and so forth. And I want to know who my mother is." And so she went about locating and found her biological mother. It turned out that the child had been taken away simply because they said she was an unfit mother. And now that mother and daughter are back together. The National Center for Child Abuse and Neglect in 1998 reported that 6 times as many children died in foster care than in the general public. Ladies and gentlemen, 6 times as many died in foster care than in the general public, and that once removed to official safety, so to speak, these children are far more likely to suffer abuse. Now, that includes sexual molestation, more so than in the general public. And we have had many, many young girls come here in what California calls the Emancipation Program. And that means a young lady has reached 18, 19 years of age, and she is turned out of the system. That is, she's not with a foster family. She's in a home in the system. And the system says, "We don't get money for you if you turn 18. That's a stipulation. And so they get turned out on the street, and they come to our homeless shelter. Broke, nowhere to go, and we take them in. At that point, many of those young girls tell horror stories of being in foster homes where they were raped and brutally taken advantage of. According to the California Little Hoover Commission report, That was back in 2003. 30 to 70% of the children in California group homes, listen to this, 30 to 70% of the children in California group homes do not belong there and should not have been removed from their homes. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to remind you that you can reach us. I want to remind you that we have in our hands about 23 or 24 things that the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals said in reference to this issue. Ladies and gentlemen, we must work with people like this gentleman, that Lawless America. And we want you to know Bill Windsor. If you know anything about Bill, you want to let me know. I need your help. I believe he's a good man. I believe he's on target. I believe he's out to help the children. I believe he's out to help our country. And I believe he's out to help Wiley Drake and Corey and others. I believe they're about helping us take America's families back. We must protect the families of America, and we encourage you to do so. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to remind you that when you listen to our show, the last show or two, we've done a lot about this whole issue of child protection and child protective services, and we'll continue to do some of that. But we don't just deal with that. That's only one-third of our ministry. The other two-thirds is showing mercy and walking with God. So we're going to do everything we can to help this injustice of killing babies and this injustice of taking children away from their parents, all because of the money. The court has held in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeal. And if you don't have this report, you need to get it from me. You just need to send me an email and title your subject, What the Ninth Circuit Court Said About CPS. Now, folks, this is not some crazy pastor. This is not some crazy guy traveling around the country. This is what Ninth Circuit Court said when they sent this case up to the Supreme Court. They held that the seizures under circumstances violated the Fourth Amendment. Ladies and gentlemen, they cannot take your children without a warrant. They cannot take your children without a warrant. Please don't let them take them. Several courts have found that CPS agents investigating child abuse are the functional equivalent of police officers. The juvenile dependency system, folks, this is a quote from the Ninth Circuit, and I quote, the juvenile dependency system in this country is dysfunctional. Now, folks, I didn't say that. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals said it. Even Justice Carlos Moreno of the California Supreme Court has noted that the system is in need of major overhaul. Ladies and gentlemen, we must overhaul the system. Even the courts say that. I'm of the opinion that the system is beyond repair, I'm sorry to say, but even repair would be better than nothing. Repair would be better than the dysfunction that's going on as we speak. I want to encourage you, go to Mr. Bill Windsor's website and check the website out, Lawless America, Lawless America. Check it out. Find out what God's doing in and through his life. And find out, and Bill, I want you to know you're welcome on this show anytime. You're welcome to have any of this data that we have. Any of you out there are welcome to have this data if you'd like to see it. And the joining forces, it says, the Ninth Circuit, is required. One could surmise The only reason those agents went to the school and interrogated a little girl was that they were trying to skirt the constitutional warrant. This has become a widespread practice among police and teachers. No remedy exists in the juvenile courts for abuse of constitutional rights. The Ninth Circuit also says the vast majority of agents lack education and training required to qualify them even as a plain professional, let alone CPS. The Ninth Circuit goes on to say this also means that 84% of caseworkers have no education background or training to work in the field that allows them to make monumentous decisions about whether children should be removed or not. Other systemic issues illustrate the need for a check on the power of CPS agents. Ladies and gentlemen, I didn't say that. A judge in the Ninth Circuit. The government's vital interest in preventing child abuse does not require, they say, sacrifice of Fourth Amendment protection. Now, let me give you another quote that ought to scare the heck out of every one of us. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals says, money, we've been talking about money. The Ninth Circuit says, money creates a perverse incentive in the juvenile system. Since the funding is tied to the removal and adoption of children, little effort is made to keep children at home with the services to the parents. The longer children remain out of the home, and here's that incentive, the longer the children remain out of the home, the more money CPS receives. This funding under Title 4E of the Social Security Act has spawned, now listen to what the court says. They say this funding under Title 4E of the Social Security Act has spawned a huge child abuse industry. Now, they're not talking about child abuse parents. They're talking about an industry. And the Ninth Circuit reported to the Supreme Court, and that case indeed was won, but the Ninth Circuit said this funding has spawned a huge child abuse network. It is the function of the neutral magistrate, that's the judge, not a CPS agent, to determine what constitutes probable cause. And ladies and gentlemen, probable cause must be provided, especially in these cases where children are being taken away. Would you please pray for the families that have been and are being destroyed by CPS? Stories are coming in from all over America and literally all over the world. We heard some. Hello, God bless you. Are you there?
Yes, I'm sorry to interrupt.
No, that's okay. I'm sorry we didn't answer your...
I was calling to talk about my book, The Treasure Chamber, but I got into your conversation, and I practiced law in Louisiana for a long time, and what you're saying about child protection is absolutely 100% correct.
Well, we know it is because the court...
had their kids taken away simply because, like you said, they may not have had sufficient food or the kids may not have been dressed appropriately or they, like you said, they go into the home, they look around the house, they said the house is messy and accuse them of neglecting their kids. But one thing I do want to point out is one way that they use to keep the kids in foster care for a longer period of time is that they intimidate the parents.
Yep.
And they say, well, if you don't go along, if you don't admit that you've been neglecting your kids and agree to go along, plans, it'll take longer for you to get your kids back.
I can't.
The judge says, but that's what the social workers will say.
Yeah, and I can't tell you the number of times. Yeah, I can't tell you the number of times that parents have said to me, Pastor Drake, they said, if we don't cooperate, we'll never get our kids back.
And absolutely right. And you see, the children are entitled to legal representation, so they usually get public defenders. But the parents will often have to hire their own attorneys, and, you know, of course, most of the time they can't afford to, you know, to hire an attorney. So if they can't get it, like, through the legal aid, you know, or find an attorney that's willing to do it for free, then they're on their own.
Well, and even the public defenders amongst families that are in the system and amongst those of us at work, we refer to them as public pretenders because they don't even fight for the kids. I have asked...
They go along with whatever the state wants to do instead of trying to talk to the parents, you know, and find out exactly what's going on. They become adversarial with the parents.
Well,
because of course, the public defender's office can't represent the children and the parents. So, you know, they can only represent
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Well, there, you're the one that was on earlier in reference to your book, right?
Right.
Well, listen, let me do this. We will be on again tomorrow.
Okay.
Well, that's why we're doing these shows, and that's why we're doing it. We'll be on again tomorrow morning. Where are you located? What part of the country?
Oh, I'm in Lafayette, Louisiana.
Okay, so you're on Central Time. I do another show in the morning at 10 o'clock Central Time. And you're welcome to call in on the New York show and talk about your book then, because we're running out of time now.
Okay, well, I just wanted to say thank you for bringing that up.
Well, thank you so much. And
letting people know what's going on, because most people aren't aware of it.
Amen. Now, let me give you a phone number for tomorrow morning for you to call in on at 10 o'clock in New York. That number is 585-637-7040, and that'll be on the air at 11 o'clock Eastern Time, which will be 10 o'clock in the morning Central Time there in Louisiana. So you're welcome to call in again tomorrow on that number and be on the New York show with us, and we'll talk about your book in the meantime. But before we run, we got about 2 minutes. Tell us the title of your book, would you please?
Okay, the title of my book is The Treasure Chamber. It's available on Amazon. You can get the ebook for $3.99, and it is a testimony to the power of God's love and God's grace.
All right. Thank you, my sister. We'll try to talk to you again tomorrow, and I apologize for not having you on sooner. I didn't know you were on the line, but God bless you. Have a great, great evening.
Yes, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that dear lady was supposed to be on talking about her book, and she heard the subject matter and didn't. I didn't have a producer in the studio there at Crusade Radio, and so they didn't tell me that she was on, and that's why we're going to get that beeping tone there, and that'll go away here in just a moment. We want to remind you, this is the Wiley Drake Show, doing justice, love and mercy, and walking humbly with Almighty God. I'm going to go ahead and hang that phone up so we don't have that beeping, and we are through on Crusade Radio. It is now 6 o'clock, ladies and gentlemen, in California. God bless you. Have a great day. Remember, do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God.